It was like, you know, someone who really wants to make it big in this dunya, and they say, man, I got some money, I don't know how to use it. So they go to their business buddies, got any good business ideas? Where should I be putting my money right now? The market's kind of bad, where should I invest? Right? So there's this idea of putting your money in a good place. Or finding, you know, what's called diversifying your portfolio. Right? That's called diversifying your portfolio. So you don't put all your money in one, you know, investment. You put a little here, put a little here, put a little here. What is this person doing? Ash-Shawqani rahimahullah comments, fi wujuhil khair, all kinds of faces of good things. He's like, maybe I should put a little here, a little here, a little here, a little here. So I have this diversified portfolio when I go to Allah Azza wa Jalla. It's incredible, this mindset, that if you direct it towards Allah, it brings a yield, and people direct it towards dunya to bring a yield for themselves in this dunya. Anyhow, Asan al-Ra'i also offers a really remarkable insight on the ayah. He says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى تَدُلُّ عَلَى أَنَّهُ اتَّقَى الْبُخْلُ. He says he gave and he was afraid. It illustrates he was afraid of being cheap. That's why he gave. He gave and as he was afraid, meaning while becomes haliyah. He gave as he was afraid, meaning he was afraid of becoming those who are cheap, who hold on. My teacher used to give this example about our relationship with Allah. When we give, is it really our money we're giving? Is it really ours? No. But we know, I don't know if I've told you this experiment with your kids before, try it, it's a lot of fun. You get a lollipop, you get a candy, something nice, right? And you're about to eat it, and your child sees it. What does your child say? Can I have it? Can I have it? Dad, can I please have it? Just a little. And you say, okay. You can hold it. You can have it. Just a little piece. You give it to them. Just to hold. And then you ask for it back. Can I have it back? What do they say? Mine. All of us, within seconds, it becomes yours. Allah asks us for money. Allah asks us, قَرْضًا حَسَنًا. Give me a loan. Beautiful loan. He says, let me tell you a business transaction. تِجَارَةٍ. He gives us all these terminologies. Why? Because we start believing what? It's ours. It's ours. It's not his, it's ours. SubhanAllah. We start thinking we're the owners. That's what happens with money. Money is the mal is the essential thing that makes you start thinking you're in charge. And who have you replaced psychologically? Maybe in your aqidah you still say La ilaha illallah. Maybe in your salah you still say Allahu Akbar. But what is your heart testifying to every time you look at the account balance? What's your heart testifying to? Where is your heart going? It's already testified that I own this wealth. This is mine. This belongs to me. Right? This is the attitude that Allah is striking at the heart. أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى. He gave and he was afraid he might start thinking this belongs to him. So he gave lots of it. He gave lots of it. The other thing also that's really interesting is, you put a lot of money in a sure deal. You put a little bit of money when you're not so sure if it's gonna, you know, maybe it's a good investment, I'm not so sure. So I'm not gonna put all my savings in it, I'll put a little bit. But if it's a guaranteed investment, what do? Like guaranteed. You put it in, you say, man, this is the way to go. It's a sure shot, it's good real estate, it's coming up, the area is coming up, I'm gonna buy in this property, this area. I'm gonna invest in this thing or that thing. Why? Because it's a sure deal. So the amount we give increases when what we start believing that it's a sure deal. And the more you like, there are other better places this could be spent, the less you give. Right? And so this person fears, before my other instinct kicks in and I say, no, maybe I shouldn't give this much, before he even gets to that point, he just gives, أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى. This is his attitude. And so Allah Azza wa Jal, when he speaks about this, actually another couple of things we should talk about here is the sequence. Usually, a'ta is giving a lot. It's not even giving a little. A'ta, I said, is a hyperbolized form of the verbs. So this guy is giving a lot. But you would think taqwa comes first, and then you do ihsan, you give a lot. Right? So it seems like taqwa comes first, and then you give a lot. But what does the ayah say? A'ta wa taqwa. It mentions the giving a lot first, and taqwa second. It mentions taqwa second. And this is part of the style of this entire surah. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the conclusion first, and then the root second. And we'll find this throughout this surah. It's beautiful. Even, what's the conclusion? This dunya or the akhirah? The akhirah. He says, and so which should be mentioned first? Dunya first, akhirah second. When we come to that ayah, what does he say? وَإِنَّ لَنَا لَلْآخِرَةَ وَالْأُولَى. He mentions first, the hereafter, then he mentions the first. So this is part of the beautiful, remarkable style of this surah. You want to reach that point? What's the seed? You want to see the tree? think about the root. The root is taqwa. For an individual, the sequence is he confirms the truth, then he has taqwa, fear of consequence, and then finally he becomes giving. This is when thinking about an individual. But when you think about a society, human beings, they always think about themselves. But if we want to live as a civilization, you know one of the first things you have to give up? You can't have everything for yourself. You have to contribute back to society in every which way. To be part of a society, you have to give. You can't be part of a society without giving. So giving comes first on a societal scale. And then after giving, that's obviously one of the... we're not even talking about Islamic society. Any society, if you want to be part of a civilization, you have to give. The second thing you have to do is you have to abide by the law. When you come into society, you have to give and you have to abide by the law. You have to be afraid of the consequences of breaking the law. What is that? Taqwa. And finally, the ideal society will be the one in which the citizens give, they abide by the law, but they take that final step and make it the ideal society, they confirm the truth. Which is what? Islam. The ultimate truth. So the final evolution of a society is وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى. So the progression of an individual is one way, and the progression of society is in reverse. It's an interesting comment made by Dr. Fadl Salih al-Samarai in regards to this ayah. We'll read something that Shawkani rahimahullah wrote in his remarkable tafsir, Fathul Qadir. أَعْطَى حَقَّ اللَّهِ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِ. When he says, he confirmed the truth, he interprets that to mean, he gave the right of Allah that he recognized was binding upon him. Meaning he realized what he gives isn't his. It's Allah's right over him. Allah demands. He gives you wealth and says, then spend. Hassan radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, أَعْطَى الصِّدْقِ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ. He gave, or he confirmed, the truth that, مِنْ قَلْبِهِ rather, that was deep in his heart. وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى أَيْ بِلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And he confirmed the ultimate good, which is to confirm, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. وَبِهِ قَالَ الضَّحَاكُ وَالسَّلْمِي. Dihak and Salmi also said the same thing. And Mujahid says, بِالْحُسْنَى, as I mentioned before, the ultimate good refers to Al-Jannah. وَقَالَ زَيْدِ بْنُ أَسْلَمْ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَالصَّوْمِ. And others said, Zayd bin Aslam said, this ultimate good is what? He confirmed the value and good in salah and in zakah and in salah, meaning obedience to Allah. Meaning obedience to Allah. But the first, according to Ash-Shawkani, فَالْأَوَّلْ أُولَى, meaning the first, the right of Allah binding upon him, that is the first. Because when you think about that, then all of these things come under it. Right? All of these things, meaning the salah, the zakah, la ilaha illallah, all of those things fall under the right of Allah upon us. So that's how he interprets, وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى. Then, if he fulfills these conditions, then what's going to happen? فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى. Then we will make ease for him. We will facilitate for him. Who's we? It is Allah Azza wa Jal speaking. He says, we will make ease for him. In other words, until he makes easy, it's not easy. Until he makes easy, it stays difficult. But for the person who makes this commitment, number one, Allah makes an ease for him. But he doesn't even stop there. He says, lil yusra. Yusra is the feminine equivalent of aysar. Aysar means the easiest. The easiest. So Allah says, I will make the easiest easy for him. Actually, He says, I will make the easiest really easy for him. Now, the way you're thinking about good deeds now, according to Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah's gift to this person is, he finds doing good things what? Easy. And he finds them the easiest thing to do. Meaning doing bad things he finds hard, and the easiest, the most natural thing that comes to him is doing good things. Can you imagine what a gift is from Allah? Most of us, when we do good things, it's hard. When we do bad things, it's what? It's easy. That's easy. Good things are hard. But this attitude, أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى, guess what gift you get in this dunya? Allah will make the easiest thing easy upon you. Meaning, your attitude about it will change, and it will be the easiest thing facilitated for you, subhanAllah. Now what is this, and by the way in Arabic, for ease in the Qur'an two words are used, yasir and hayyin. Like, huwa alayya hayyin. Yasir means a task that is done without any difficulty. Hayyin means a task that you are given that is way beneath your skill set. Like if you give a calculus professor a math problem that says, what's 1 plus 1? That would be hayyin for him. It's like an insa. Come on, give me something serious, right? That's hayyin, way too easy for him. But yasir means a task which may be up to your skill, but you can perform it without falling into any difficulty. Even though it's at your level or at your capacity, it's still, you can follow it without any difficulty. The tafsir of this we find in the promise of Allah to us in Surah Al-Hajj, when he says, وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. We did not put for you at all in this religion any difficulty, constriction whatsoever. We didn't put any difficulty in it whatsoever. For some people, prayer is very hard. Prayer is very hard. Can't wake up, gotta finish quickly. As soon as they get into it, they start hyperventilating, like, I gotta get this over with. You know? For some people, prayer is hard. For the Prophet ﷺ, everything was hard except what? Prayer. His biggest desire is what? جُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ صلى الله عليه وسلم. The coolness of my eyes, my relaxation, my comfort, my escape was placed where? In the salah. This is فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى. Now, Allah promised His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, وَنُيَسِّرُكَ لِلْيُسْرَى. We find this ayah also, وَنُيَسِّرُكَ لِلْيُسْرَى. I will make the easiest thing easy for you, صلى الله عليه وسلم. Allah is giving us the same option, but there's a difference. There Allah said, وَنُيَسِّرُكَ. Here He says, فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ. There's a scene extra here. When Allah promised His Messenger, He said, I will make easy for you. Okay? But here He says, soon I will make easy for him. Soon. For His Messenger, He did not say soon. But for us, for any other person aspiring to reach this ease, He says soon. Why? The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is content. And his heart is already in this direction. And he's not at unrest with his Lord. So when you say soon, why do you say soon to someone? To help them calm down, right? Because they're not at rest. They're perturbed. Hey, it's coming soon, it's coming soon. Right? It's a way of easing you. So it's showing that the nature of the relationship between Allah and His Messenger ﷺ is very tranquil. And we're not that tranquil. So we want to rush to it. So Allah gives us more consolation when He says, سَنُيَسِّرُهُ. He will make ease for him, lil yusra. The Arabs used to talk about the horse. You know, the horse is hard to ride without a saddle and the seat and the reins. When you hook up the horse totally, when it's like comfortable to ride, they would say, yassara al-faras. Now it's easy to ride. That's how the word yassara was originally used. So what Allah is saying is, I will make all the arrangements for you to do the good deed. The horse will be totally prepared. All you got to do is just sit there and move the rope a little. That's all you got to do. All the arrangements for you to perform well and to do the things that will elevate your status with Allah will be made easy for you. All the doors will be opened. All the doors will be opened. يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِ يُسْرًا. Whoever has taqwa of Allah, Allah will make in every one of his decisions, He'll make some ease for him. وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. He'll provide him from where you couldn't even imagine. He'll start opening doors you didn't think even existed. All you get this attitude, you start seeing how Allah starts making things easy for you. Similarly, we find in the hadith narrated in al-Bukhari, the Messenger says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اعملوا, get to work.